Sensei is a Japanese word that means teacher. And I teach Ishinru Karate for the Recreation Department of Bethel Park at Bethel Park Community Center. I've been in Ishinru Karate for over half a century. And it's been my observation that violence is always emphasized, but the better virtues of karate is seldom seen. In this series, my purpose is to acquaint you, the viewer, with the benefits of martial arts training in general and Ishinru Karate specifically. So whether you are a martial artist already, or whether you're a person who's thought of taking martial arts, or if you're someone with no interest whatsoever in martial arts, I think you'll find this program to be a benefit to you. My name is Chuck Wallace, but my students call me Sensei. I've noticed an overwhelming amount of information about meditation. Newspapers, magazines, on television, on the radio. The interest in meditation seems to be at an all-time high. And never in the last 50 years of my martial arts practice have I ever seen the like of it. Meditation has captured the interest of the people. So that's the reason I thought my topic should be meditation first today. There are so many benefits to it. The brain is working all the time, most people's brain. And from time to time, a person needs to disengage. The person needs just to be. And meditation provides a vehicle to achieve that goal, just to be. When you have nothing on your mind, everything is easier for you to do. And you can accomplish things that you didn't think you could accomplish. Now, it's no great secret, it's no great mystery how meditation works. There are many different types of meditation. I've tried a few, and for most of my years in the martial arts, I've pursued Zazen, Zen meditation. And Zen meditation is the meditation known to have been practiced by the Buddhist monks in the temples, the Shaolin Temple, high in the Himalayan mountain range in China, and by the samurai of China and also of Japan. Prior to going into battle, the samurai would practice their meditation. It had a calming effect. It gave them a centered effect. It let them relax. It gave them some rest. And it made them afterwards think far more clearly than they would have thought otherwise. So they went as far in the samurai days as to say any activity of value should be preceded by a meditation. Well, the meditation I practice, of course, Zazen, is simple enough. It's just a matter of doing it. Like anything else, knowing how to do it is not quite enough. You need to practice it, and you need to practice it on a daily basis. Some people meditate twice a day, some people only once. I meditate prior to every single karate workout, and I have felt for many, many years my meditation makes my workout better, and I achieve more during that workout. So let me tell you a little bit about the technique itself. Meditation, Zazen. There are, of course, the historical ways of sitting in the lotus position on the floor with the legs crossed. Some stylists will sit on their knees with their hands on their thighs. But I think it's more practical for most people, myself included, to sit in a chair. To sit in a chair that has a good, strong back, support in the lower back. A chair high enough that the thighs are parallel to the floor. We sit with our back straight, our head pulled back, our chin tucked in. We want to try to breathe from the lower abdomen, belly breathing. Now, most people in this country breathe from the chest. So when they inhale, the chest rises up. And when they exhale, the chest drops down. We need to try to breathe with the lower abdomen so that when we inhale, the belly goes out. And when we exhale, the belly comes back in. It isn't absolutely necessary that you breathe from the lower abdomen in order to have a successful meditation, but it's a good habit to try to form. Because if you practice it enough, you'll find yourself breathing more from the belly than from the chest. You're able to process more air that way. You're able to feed the body with more oxygen in the extremities as well as in the brain. So that should be one goal, breathing from the lower abdomen. Secondly, we want to close our eyes. They can remain slightly open, and we can look at an angle about 3 feet in front of us. We want to do our breathing through our nose, and we want as much as possible for that breathing to be normal. Normal in volume and normal in effort. Just an effortless in and out breathing through the nose. The difference is in Zazen and some other styles of meditation that we take a normal inhale through the nose, but we take an extended exhale. So we might do mentally a count of 4 on the inhale, then a count of 8 on the exhale. And this is the way we breathe throughout the meditation period. Meditation period could last anywhere from 10 to 20 minutes, more if you're so inclined. But if you use the long exhale, you'll find a greater calming effect than if you just breathe in 4, breathe out 4. So try the long exhale when you practice your Zazen. Now, it's a good idea as you do your Zazen to not try to not think of anything. If thoughts come to your mind, let them come in one way and pass out the other, like clouds passing across the sky. Don't dwell on them. You can recognize the thought, but then dismiss it. Let it move on. And so you want to think only of the count of your breathing. That's what you want to focus on, and be relaxed in the process. Meditation can do a lot of things for us. A lot of people today are seeking happiness. They seek happiness in an outward manner, a lot of times by having more things, perhaps more money. Everyone wants more money. Perhaps more, a finer car, perhaps more possessions. And yet, no matter much how much some folks accumulate, it doesn't bring happiness. And the reason is that the happiness is within. And Zazen, Zen meditation, is one way for us to access the happiness within, the calming within. Every day of my life at age 76, I feel good. Like any human being, I can get sick, and on great occasion I might. But if I do become sick, I'm able to heal much faster than I believe I would were I not a meditator and a martial arts practitioner. So there are so many benefits to meditation that it's very, very important. 5, 10 minutes, you're accessing a part of the brain called the hypothalamus. And the hypothalamus is the ancient brain, as some people call it. And within the hypothalamus, there's a state of relaxation. Some people say it's your normal self. That's normalcy. You're achieving normalcy. Some go as far as the Taoists of ancient China did to say that your plugging into the source of the universe, that you're plugging in to that source of power. If you believe that or not really doesn't matter much, because what it is, we might not understand, but what we do understand is it works. It works, and people are practicing it all over this country every day. And I would advise you to try it. Give it a try. I think you'll enjoy it. I think it'll give you some rest and some peace. You'll be happier. You'll feel healthier. And it's just a good thing to do for yourself. I'm going to demonstrate now how I meditate. If you meditate sitting in a chair as I do, there are two things you can do with your hands. The first is to have them as I have mine, resting on your thighs near the knee. Be sure that there's a bend in the elbow. You don't want to have your arms straight and your elbows locked. You want to be relaxed. Another way is to have your hands in front of you at the lower abdomen with your left hand cupped in the palm of your right hand. Either way is appropriate. Either way is traditional. Either way is functional. I'm going to begin so you can have some idea what the meditation process looks like from your perspective. Begin. Now, one of the advantages of having your hands in this position is with your hands right up against your belly, you're able to feel the belly pushing out as you inhale and drawing in as you exhale. Whereas you miss out on that sensation when you have your hands on your thighs forward toward the knee. Both are acceptable and both work well. Now, when we come back, I'm going to demonstrate the kata sanshin. Sanshin is a kata that has the meaning of three challenges: body, mind, and spirit. And the challenge is to unify your body, mind, and spirit through the practice and performance of sanshin. Sanshin has been called by many meditation in motion. We'll be right back.
Distracted driving has been called an epidemic. Unfortunately, many of us drive distracted. So what is distracted driving?
It is driving while engaged in any activity that could divert a person's attention away from the prime task of driving.
Texting, making phone calls, putting on makeup, reaching for objects, changing the CD or radio channel is part of an endless list that put us at risk. The following statistics should make each of us think about making changes in the way we drive or ride in a car. In 2012, over 3,000 people were killed and 421,000 were injured as a result of distracted driving.
In 2011, it was estimated that a typical daylight moment, at least 660,000 cars were being driven by drivers using handheld cell phones.
40% of teenagers have been in a car with a person using a cell phone while driving in a way that put others in danger. Driving while using a cell phone reduces the amount of brain activity devoted to driving by 37%.
Change the way you drive. Speak up for your safety.
Drive without texting or talking on your cell phone. Make calls or texts prior to driving. Pull over to a safe location to text or check emails. Stop texting or talking on cell phones to others that are driving. It all starts with you.
Although very little has been written about the martial arts in terms of its origin and progression through the years and through the different countries where the martial arts grew, it's generally believed that meditation has existed for hundreds, if not thousands of years. Now, how meditation advanced to the moves of karate is a story that there is only a theory about. Bodhidharma was a Zen Buddhist priest from India who traveled across the Himalayan mountain range and settled in the Shaolin Temple and taught the Zen novice priests meditation. In the process of teaching these novices, he found they were not able to concentrate and to focus. And so he showed them a series of exercises or moves, which most martial artists today believe were the forerunners of the martial arts, specifically Kung Fu and the different styles of karate. One of the most important of these series of moves, or what we now call katas, is known as Sanshin, S-A-N-C-H-I-N. That's the Japanese word. Now, Sanshin is found not only in my style, Isshinryu Karate, but in many, many styles. In China, in Okinawa, in Japan, Korea, and around the world, even Indonesia and some other countries in that area. So Sanshin is believed to be, if not one of the original exercises that Bodhidharma taught those novice priests at the Shaolin Temple. If it's not one of them, it's a combination or a compilation of those moves. But it's survived for hundreds of years and is seen in most any style. Not always the same. There are different versions of it, some versions longer than others. But all styles practice, almost all styles, practice Sanshin and rate it very highly on their scale of importance. It's so highly rated that it's generally considered to be unique among the katas. If you mentioned from prior programs, I mentioned that a kata is like a real fight against imaginary opponents. Sanshin could be an exception to that general rule. And a lot of people, myself included, believe that Sanshin produces and builds energy, vital energy, that the Chinese call qi and the Japanese call ki. All things are believed to have qi, to have that life energy. And when your qi goes out, you go out at the same time. There's nothing religious about it. It's a matter of believing in the energy that the body possesses. And Sanshin is believed to build and balance that qi. And I'm a firm believer in it. My instructor, William H. Dissel, who was a 10th degree black belt, promoted just a few months before he passed away at age 87. When he and I had our personal workouts, and I was his student for 50 years, we began and ended every single practice, every single personal workout with Sanshin. Tatsuo Shimabuku, the founder of Isshinryu Karate, says that it takes 20 years to learn Sanshin, to understand the intricacies. And the intricacies involve proper breathing and proper movement and proper expansion and contraction of the various muscle groups. All of the muscles come into play. You have a firm stance that you're in. You should be loose in the upper body, and the tightness should only be for a second at the end of each move, each punch or block. Sanshin is a study in itself, but it's the single most important, in my estimation, the single most important kata that we have in Isshinryu Karate specifically, and in the martial arts in general. I'm going to perform Sanshin for you now. It's hard to understand what the kata is, but the feeling one receives from doing it is very invigorating. All that breathing and the movement combined. And this is the way we unify body, mind, and spirit. This is the spiritual side of the martial arts. Sanshin Kata.
BPTV is a benefit to any organization in Bethel Park. Not only do they have the community bulletin board, but you can also produce your own shows, which is a really fun and interesting way to get your information into the community. The library is currently producing 4 shows. They're all available on YouTube, also on the library's website, and you can see them in rotation on BPTV. It's a way to get the staff's face known in the community so that when we're out at the Giant Eagle, you recognize us and say, hey, I saw you on BPTV, and that's a lot of fun for us. I've worked in 2 other communities as a librarian, and while both had TV studios in their school districts, I didn't know about the service, and I was never approached to say, hey, you want to do a show or a promo or anything. In that way, I find BPTV to be really fantastic for any organization in the Bethel Park community. I find that BPTV is very proactive. I've been approached about show ideas, and I've also feel welcome to go down to the office and pitch an idea. BPTV staff and volunteers are very helpful and very knowledgeable. Another good opportunity is to send a couple members of your organization over to BPTV to be trained on the equipment in case there aren't volunteers available. There is an emphasis in education in general, and libraries in particular, to create maker spaces, which are areas where people can come and use equipment to create music or music videos or videos of any kind, or also stop motion animation. With BPTV right here, the library has not had to invest in that kind of space, where many other libraries are doing so across the country. Right here in Pittsburgh, the Carnegie Library of Pittsburgh has spent a tremendous amount of money to create maker spaces in their facilities, and we're fortunate that we don't have to do that. BPTV is indeed the pulse of Bethel Park. It is a wonderful state-of-the-art community asset. Residents of Bethel Park are very lucky to live in a community that supports not only a state-of-the-art television studio, but also a fantastic community center and a library. It's a great opportunity to learn and also to promote your organization. I'm Christine McIntosh, Executive Director of Bethel Park Public Library and producer of Check It Out on BPTV.
This program has been of interest to you today. There's no doubt in my mind that if you follow the instruction on meditation, you'll be better off for it. It has to be done every day. It only takes a few minutes, but I don't know of a single thing a person can do with 10 or 15 minutes a day that can benefit them as much. The one important thing that you must remember as far as your meditation is concerned. The Japanese have a word, mushotoku. And mushotoku means without thought toward profit or gain. That's the way you must practice your zazen, with no thought toward profit or gain. Just do it. Do it as I recommended it. Do it consistently, and I know you'll benefit from it as the time goes by. I hope also that you enjoyed some of the background I've given you on the early evolvement of the martial arts in the Asian area and Sanshin Kata, which is something that, although I said that Master Shimabuku said it took 20 years to learn, I honestly think it took me 30. Maybe I'm a slow learner. But in taking that time, I have a great belief in it and a lot of confidence in what Sanshin has done for me. And I look forward to the aging process. At age 76, so far I'm aging pretty well. And I hope that my martial arts, my meditation, Sanshin, and everything else I do will help me in that respect. Thank you for your attention, and I look forward to spending time with you again. Thank you.
From a very young age, I was exposed to sports in a great way. My uncle was on the first pro basketball team in Pittsburgh, the Pittsburgh Ironmen. And my dad, of course, that was my hero. He was a basketball referee for over 30 years. Just been a passion in my life. And as I got older, I found out about horses and I ended up owning a stable. And I was asked to be on a sports show with Roger Houston called the Meadows Racing Network. And when we were done, I said, boy, that'd be something great. Maybe someday I could have a TV show. Back in 2011, I had a conversation with some friends about sports that piqued my interest in how could we start a sports talk show on TV? Well, I found out I could go to Public Access TV in Bethel Park and I'd be able to produce my own sports talk TV show. The great thing about doing two sports talk shows on BPTV is I can share my passion about sports with thousands of people every week. If you are passionate about something that you would like to share with the community, I encourage you to come to BPTV and produce a show like I do. I'm Al Levine, volunteer producer of Pittsburgh Sportsline on BPTV.